Okay then. Nice to see so many of you here. I was actually going to do a small little container presentation this fall, and then for some reasons it didn't happen, and then January came and went, and then February, that would be a good time to present something with containers. Wonder if anyone will listen. And we ended up with a wait list, so apparently some of you want to hear about containers. So initially I was going to talk about Podman and Kubernetes, but then I recognized no one knows what Podman is yet, so that's why I wrote Docker in the presentation. So we will see how we can run Linux containers without Docker daemon. And this Docker daemon is a bit complicated, and we will go into this during this tonight. But first, some background then. This one is... So here is a small overview then. And who here hasn't heard about containers at all? Great. Then I will explain what I think containers are to begin with. And now we'll look into some different projects. There's a lot of acronyms and so on. So we'll go through a few of them. So we will look at Podman, and we look at Docker, and we look at Kubernetes and some of the projects around it, including Minikube, which is then a way to run Kubernetes on your app. But first then, so this containers thing is actually not that new. You could, if you want, you could say the whole thing started with a root command, which then enables you to have a second file root, like if you want to try a new operating system. And in the beginning, it was not so very contained. The first way to escape a shroot was cd dot dot, and then you're out of the shroot. And this has improved over the years. So then shroot is a way to handle the files in a namespace. And something that is also useful and was pioneered with Yates was you have this root user, and this root user can do everything. There was a bunch of complicated access control lists and so on, how to not make root everything. And then someone came up with the idea, let's have a almost root that can do everything in his process tree. So then we have a process tree, which is then Unix processes starting with P1. And you have a second P1 running inside the system. And all of this happened like last millennia, last 100 years ago. But in the Linux world, when I started with it, we were running Linux hosting. And back in those days, you could either get a shared account where you ran your PHP or whatever script, or you could get a private server. And the private server was very expensive, and then the shared account was very limited. So then a company called Virtuoso came up with this idea to do a virtual private server. And this was then based on container technology, and this was open sourced in 2005 and became then OpenVC. So now we have this way of running processes in a machine. So we could have a separate file tree, a separate process tree, and separate users. And in the case of Virtuoso, you could also monitor networking. So when you had a virtual private server, you could build those clients only for network traffic going from that part of the server. So what do you think happened next? Containers ruled the world, right? No, what happened was that everyone started running VMware. So there came a dark decade of virtual machines instead of containers and containers. So these virtual private servers became VEs, so virtual environments, which then become containers. And there was a, besides OpenVC, there was also a second project called LXC for Linux containers, that were bundling some of the tools needed with this container technology. So all of this technology was available and was running then in 2005. the problem was that it was not running on the main kernel, so you needed a specialized kernel. And that was probably the main reason why it didn't take off then. So what the OpenVC guys did, they are mostly Russian developers. They split their code into things that they could upstream and things that could stay in user space. And then they contributed this to the Linux kernel, and this is what eventually, after a lot of other guys, like Google developers and so on, became C groups. So all of this technology is now available in the Linux kernel, assuming you have a new enough version. So then, back when we started, then the container was an alternative to the virtual machines. So by then, it was the natural thing was that you would have something resembling a virtual machine. So you would run an entire operating system in your container with all the software installed in a normal fashion. But nowadays, we talk about application containers. So now it's normal and pioneered by Solomon Hanks and Docker to package your application in a container. So instead of having OS containers, which was the norm back when LXE started, we now have application containers. So instead of an entire operating system, it's those libraries you need for your software to package. And this is more of a way of thinking of it, because we will see when we actually look at it that they are still a small operating system, and there's still an init process, even though they didn't want to acknowledge it at first. But this enabled us to run the applications directly on the host operating system, instead of having a hypervisor and a second operating system. So we have one kernel with containers instead of two kernels with a virtualization. And this then means a lower footprint, but also more interaction with the underlying hardware. So if you want to access hardware, you don't have to do it through a virtual layer. You can access the real hardware directly, which has pros and cons. So, 5 years in the dark, and then Docker appeared. So this small PaaS provider called DotCloud announced that they were going to open source their container orchestration or container allocation tool called Docker. And shortly thereafter, they renamed their company to Docker, and it's been available ever since. So this is what nowadays most people equate containers with Docker, even though the technology has been around for a long time, even in the by Linux standard. Normally then you have a Docker engine or the normal Docker CE that you can install on the laptop. It consists of two components. So there's one client called Docker, and there is one daemon that is now spun off into a separate process called Docker D. So when you write the Docker command, you will send a REST API's command to a daemon running on your laptop as well. And this is a normal mode of operation of Docker. There were some other products announced a couple of years after the main Docker. I'm going to highlight a few of those because we will get back to those later. So, if you were running on, say, a Windows computer or a Mac computer, you have no way of booting this Linux container. So they made a small operating system that was called boot to Docker. So that was what it did when you started it. It booted the Docker daemon. That was the main purpose of OS. This was orchestrated by a command line tool called Docker Machine. So Docker Machine will spin up a VM for you, and then you have this Docker client on your own machine that can then talk to the Docker server, which is on this VM. So this Docker client can be your Windows machine, and the Docker server can be this Linux machine that is required. And in this way, the Docker API became accessible to Windows and Mac users, and also to Linux users that were running an older kernel, or didn't have privileges to run their own kernel or their own root daemon, or what have you. And once announced in the same announcement at the end of 2014, was the Docker Swarm tool, which was then a way to spin up containers on more than one host. So you could run containers on multiple hosts and have them stop and start and so on. And a third tool was Docker Compose. And Docker Compose allowed you to start more than one container by describing them in a single file. So if you had a web server talking to a database or what have you, you could describe them in one file instead of having to start multiple containers manually. So things were moving quite fast. So this was 2013 for Docker and 2014. And then in 2015, they announced the collaboration called Open Container Initiative, or OCI. And OCI then is it's run by the Linux Foundation, and it's a standardization of some of these formats used by Docker. So they standardized a way to run the containers, and they standardized the image specification. And this was then based on the Docker implementation, but formulated as a standard that can be implemented by anyone. And this runtime specification is then what was implemented by a reference implementation called RunC. So RunC is a container runtime that includes all the code that was previously in Docker in a lib container library as a standalone binary. So all the system bits needed to talk with the Linux kernel are then encapsulated in this RunC component. And then in Docker version 1.11, it was now running RunC to start to talk to the Linux containers. And orchestrating this Linux container was another daemon. So we have the Docker daemon talking to the container daemon. And the container daemon is the daemon that provides extra functionality like logging or restarting containers that die. So, and this was then introduced in the same Docker 1.11 version back in the end of 2015. So we now have there is a standard tool running standardized images. And governed by a standards body called OCI. And what you could then do is you could implement a different implementation than the Docker engine that talks to the same Docker images. So you can take your Docker images from Docker Hub or what have you, Docker Registry, and you can run them in any runtime following the runtime specification. And that is what mostly Red Hat, but also some other developers have been doing for a while. So they have developed this tool called Podman. And Podman then is a way to run containers. It's similar to Docker in that it implements a lot of the Docker API, the Docker commands. So you can do Podman PS or Podman images. But it does this without talking to the Docker daemon. So it will start the containers directly without the daemon. Which means that you are will be in the same SE Linux context, and you will be in the same process tree. Whereas where in with Docker, you would send a command to the server, and then the server will execute. And this Podman tool has a companion tool called Builder. And Builder is named the way it is because the main lead of this project is located in Boston, and that's how they talk in Boston. So it also has a Boston Terrier command. But this is similar then to the commands you run in a Docker file. So as most of you probably know, if you've been running Docker, you will describe your Docker image by listing commands in a file. And that means that you need to use those commands available in that file. So if you want to copy something, you need to follow the copy command of the Docker file with all its quirks and bugs. And if you want to install a package, you will have to run a program inside the container, which means you have to bundle apt with the rest of your OS and so on. With Builder, they take another approach. So you will have the same commands like from scratch or what have you, but they are available as CLI tools. So you can, at each step, you can do other commands. You can script in whatever language you want, and then you can mount the file system of the image and use the regular CP tool or tar or apt or what have you to install the files directly into the container instead of having to use whatever syntax the Docker files allow you to use for the day. But if you have a lot of Docker files that you have already written and you're quite happy with, it also supports the Docker file syntax. So you can run the Docker files. And this is this tool is then built into Podman, so you can do Podman build and it will Podman build that for you. You can also install the tools. So it's Podman and Podman and Builder, and there's Podman.io and Builder.io has more information about the products. To implement these, we need then this runtime. So we will use run C, which is the same as Docker was using to run the containers. So that's why the without the Docker daemon comes in, because run C kinda is from Docker, so but it's a standard. But we want this logging and so on. So what Podman does is that it uses a component from the Kubernetes implementation to monitor the containers. It's called conmon, which means then container monitor. And it will do the things that container D does in Docker, monitor the containers and collect logs and so on. So it's the exact same component as from Kubernetes. We also need networking for our containers, and in Docker this is implemented by a custom component called a libnetwork, which is an internal library similar to a lib container, of course, before runs. In Kubernetes there is a standard called the container network interface, or CNI. So again, Podman uses a Kubernetes component. And it has a bunch of implementations, so there are different default implementations, almost a dozen of them, implementing bridges and various providers of network. One familiar to Kubernetes users is Flannel, for instance, but most of the time for the demo purposes I will use, we'll use something simple like a bridge or a host global network. But you can do very advanced network plugins, or even write your own. And then, if you remember this boot to Docker project, it was then a way to make Docker accessible, and therefore I made this boot to Podman project. which has the same purpose. It will start a Linux kernel that has all the features you need to run containers, and it will do this in a VM, so it will work on any system. It will work on the older Linux kernels, it will work in unprivileged situations, and it will work on Windows, and it works on Windows. And writing a full Linux distribution, if you have tried to do it, it's a lot of work. So fortunately, there's the same component that both the Docker is built on, is Tiny Core Linux. And it's named Tiny Core because it has a tiny core. So the main boot file system is under 10 megabytes, which is probably as long as a blog post on Docker. So it just is a fairly recent kernel. Or at least I thought that 4.14 was new when I started with this last year, but it turns out that there are newer kernels and something.
It's the stable class. It's the latest stable.
It's the latest stable, which is not new enough to run some of the features I'm going to talk with. So now you need 4.18 for all of it. Why not 4.20 while you're new at it? So, but 4.40 is almost good enough. So it will. And this was then in the latest release of Tiny Core, called the Tiny Core 9. It's been around for over a decade. It comes in two variants, the Core, which is the CLI version, and then the Tiny Core, which is the normal desktop of Tiny Core. So for your 30 megabyte download, you will get this desktop, complete with icons and what have you. But the really nice feature of Tiny Core is that you can install software. So it has a tiny core, but you can extend that with adding more software through packages which are in this TCZ format. And these are then squashed as modules that we can load from the disk directory. So we will mount them as they are. A recent development was also to make everything available in containers. Normally you will download this ISO file and run it either on your hardware or in your virtual machine, but the same root file system can also be run in a container. So convert the build system, for instance, to do that instead of building in a VM, for all the reasons we mentioned earlier, with lower footprint and better efficiency. So I can mention that then the Tiny Core container is then 8 megabytes. It's not so much. So what did we need for the boot to Podman project? So I thought that the kernel was new enough, and it was, but then it turns out that some of the features we need to run containers are not in the default kernel configuration. So I needed to build my own kernel to enable things like memory C groups or what have you in order to run the containers. We also needed this nice overlay FS. If you've been using Docker, you know that we can layer images. And this is nowadays implemented using an overlay FS in the kernel. So that one we need to implement. You can have multiple boot images. So what you need in order to make a Linux system, shortly you need a Linux kernel, and you need a boot file system. You can have two byte boot file systems, so this is the main core Pure 64 CLI, and this boot to Podman are all the Podman tools on top of that. You can boot either where it stands now. In order to build this, you need a build package that they call compile-tc. It includes GCC and make and the normal things you want. It's similar to build essentials in Debian. And you need a Go compiler because all of this new software is written in the Go programming language. So, except for hurdles, that's all you need. And the final piece of the puzzle then is this machine. In order to easily spin up these VMs with what you have. So there is a Podman machine, command line tool, which that can then create VMs, which has everything you need in order to run Podman. Again, similar to the Docker machine. And it has a remote API, so you can talk to it as long as you are the root user. Right, so maybe it's time for some demo. If you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Is Common running as a daemon to monitor the containers?
Well, so a daemon is usually something that runs all the time. Conmon runs as a supervisor process or mother process or what have you on your container. So if you start a container, there will be a conmon. If you start two containers, there will be two conmons. If you stop those containers, the conmon will stop as well. So it's not a daemon in the traditional sense. Maybe we should try to duplicate screens on our
So were you talking about conmon?
Conmon, or container monitor.
So I have the same question maybe about the Podman
example. Yeah.
So Podman has to fork or clone, right, to create the namespaces.
Yes.
So there would be a kind of a parent process that is just hanging around in, I think, for every
or
container you start.
Yes. Or two or three, depending on, I mean, if you start it.
Can you elaborate?
No, I mean, if you have a Docker daemon that then calls, starts a container daemon and then starts around C that starts something, that you can have even more processes running around if you have a parent process to those processes. And then you can have an init process keeping track of the other processes. So, yes, there are more processes involved in the normal operation. So you can install Podman. I forgot to keep my configuration. So you can install this with apt. I have installed a newer version. So there is a released version. For some reason, there is the tracking the development branches. Mine is slightly newer. And so if we had a Docker command, if we would run like etcbox or something, now we will get a prompt. We normally prompt something like Docker. And we will try to. And you might ask, why didn't I run Docker with sudo? And this is because when you install Docker, you normally set up this root group. So now we have a root group owning this socket, and everyone in that group can talk to the Docker. Of course, we can. We can also be explicit about it. We are users. And so if we do Docker run, and then if we start this process in background, and then I apparently add a registry running as well, then we have this container running, and we can process tree maybe. Yeah, I guess that there's a shim running on, yeah, there's a lot of processes in one. But it's running at least in my normal process tree. I didn't see it in this one. So it's not in a VM or anything, but you know, it's a process. And I think I will look into more of processes in the second half when we get to Kubernetes because it's more interesting. But we will just do the same problem. So here you have the conmon process. The conmon process then runs along with all of my other desktop processes. It has this sleep, and interesting, it has a gmain function. Anyone recognize this guy? It's from a glib program. it's the main thread of a glib. In Linux, threads and processes are kind of related. It has some kind of brackets going here in PS3. So this is then the normal CLI tool running on my laptop. So it will call this one C. It will call conmon, which lives in some kind of lib folder somewhere. I forgot where it was, but it's binary anyway. And then we have this CNI thing where all these different networks are living. So this is all implemented in using regular programs. And you're all Docker experts, so we won't run any more containers just to show, just to say that you can pull the normal ones and run them. So instead we can go into Podman machine. And so Podman machine, it has a bunch of commands. You can start something, you can start, create. By default, it uses VirtualBox. If you don't want to use Oracle products or something, there is also a KMU driver, so you can use that. Hopefully. Sometimes, it depends on if I have any VirtualBox. Sometimes KVM doesn't get along with others, like VirtualBox and KVM tends to fight with that. So it will download the ISO image of the latest version if you don't have it locally, or it will cache it. It will create the SSH key so we can access it. It will create a disk image for storing the containers on. If you were paying close attention, then this tiny core Linux system was running out of RAM, so we need a disk to store things persistently. And it's booting a VM. Emulating old things from the DOS era and looking at floppy drivers. Who knows? Luckily, I have one from before. Let's see if it's Podman. So, Docker machine, Podman. If I can start my own system. So you can have multiple of these VMs, and you can start and stop them. It depends on how much memory you have in your machine. So here is the normal boot process. So now it's booted into Podman. If you want to, you can run Podman from here. Kind of sort of works also. Or you can SSH into it. And you can do the same thing from here. So you do Podman. So it's still reading Docker images from Docker.io by default. You can use your own registry, so it's compatible on the formats as we mentioned earlier. Or you can, you know these keys we generated? So it generates a unique key for this VM. So using this key we can connect to it. And there's an eval command to do all of this for you. And then there is a Python command implementing some of the Python, some of the APIs. Talk to it or listen to the images, what have you. So these commands that I run now, they were then run over SSH to this part. So that's how you talk to Podman for the time being. It doesn't use the REST API or HTTPS like in Docker Daemon does. It uses the SSH protocol to talk to the socket on the side. Right. Yeah, that's it. When you're like, when you don't want to have this machine around anymore, like this guy didn't want to boot for some reason, then you can just remove it too. And it's gone. And this download then that you are doing, unfortunately I didn't get it down to the tiny core size, so I'm sad to say it's 19 megabytes with a Docker download. So this guy, the everything you need to run Podman is now 92 megabytes. It's getting a bit bloated, but and then you get 20 gigs of storage for the disk image because it's virtual, so it's kind of tricky. So if we look at the storage of the files, and then we get on with Kubernetes before anyone falls asleep quickly here. We have the ISO file, a copy of it, just in case it updates while we are running, and yeah, we want a copy of it. And then here is the disk where we store our containers. And then here are the SSH keys we generated and some config and so on. And this is then very complicated. Right. So now we can run containers. We can do a lot of things with containers, but I'm not going to do it now. We can do it later on. Run out of things. So we can run as many containers as we can fit on one host. But what if we want to run multiple hosts? So that's where the next part comes. We can go. So a couple of years back there was an argument if you should run Docker Swarm or Kubernetes or should you run something else. It was some back and forth and then like, yeah. So now everyone's talking about Kubernetes. So if you run Docker now, it runs Kubernetes. If you run Mesos, it runs Kubernetes. So I guess Google did something right when they open source the Kubernetes project. They were running it for a decade in-house, But some of the ex-Googlers were missing some of the internal systems, and then they decided they wanted an open source version to run container orchestration for deploying, scaling, and managing containerized applications. It's controlled by a command line tool called kubectl. I'm not sure where all these CTL came from. I think Apache CTL was the first one I saw, and now everything has a CTL. I think it stands for control, but it probably doesn't.
It's kube control.
Yeah, so it's kube control and Apache control. Yeah, but it, I mean, it's the same people as the SQL, so. Anyway, so Google's approach to this, I mean, why should you run them containers? And they wanted it to be, like we talked about earlier, we have this private server where you could do anything and you had to pay for it and update it and care for it and so on. And then you have this nice shared environment where you could run your PHP application or do, I mean, you could do basically only paint within the numbers. So they are trying then to position these containers in between the infrastructure as a service and the platform as a service, which means that you don't have to care about the underlying hardware, but you can still do more. You can install libraries and you can have your dependencies in a way that you cannot do if you have a shared environment. Like your typical pass will choose the OS for you, and you can use those libraries on that OS and nothing else. So in this cloud model that I stole from Azure, where the blue things are the things you manage yourself, and the green things are what Microsoft does for you, it's in between these. CAS or something. Containers as a service. And this image we kind of recognize from the Docker thingy. Something new that Kubernetes brought to the table that also occurs in the name Podman is that you can manage a group of containers as one entity called Pod. And the reason you want to do this is because it's quite useful to have sidecar containers to your main container that can handle things like logging. It's also useful to have someone keeping track of the network, so your container doesn't have to do that. So as far as the container knows, it's running on something more similar to our old hosts. So when we were installing software directly on the servers or virtual machines, and they could talk to each other, and the same appearance a pod will give. So all the containers in the same pod will feel like they are on the same network, even though it might not actually be true in the most sense. So it has something called an infra container, which is then implemented by the runtime that implements the pod. And then you have your containers running inside the pod. And you can do this in Podman as well, so you can group containers using pods. So if you want to get started with Kubernetes then, there is this project called Minikube. And Minikube uses libmachine, which is the library version of Docker machine, to start a VM with Docker on it. And then it uses a program from Kubernetes called kubeadm to install Kubernetes on this VM. And then you have a single node Kubernetes cluster that you can play with using that. So we run Minikube start and it does this. If we then want to run it with a different container runtime, Docker is the default container runtime, then we can use this cryo implementation. It's an implementation then of the CRI standard, the container runtime standard. it's using these OCI standards for the runtime and for the images. And you give it as a flag to minikube start. But you want to run with container runtime prior. This will default on the network to use the CNI, one we saw before. And then you will have the same conmon and CNI and run C running in Kubernetes. Right. Let's see if we can do a demo of minikube. So Podman was just released in 1.0 version, and minikube is almost at 1.0 version, but there is a nice 0.34.1 version that is hopefully working. So this binary, you install a minikube, and we'll see here minikube status. It says I have a host that is stopped. I think I will try to start my old VM first. So you can do container runtime and then cryo. And then you can save some bandwidth by using this cache images flag, which will hopefully be on by default in the 1.0 release. And then some of us were talking about this before you came. We have some like Mac developers on the project. So now it's been equipped with these nice, they still feel alien to my command line. And sadly, they are still in black and white because I'm on the old Ubuntu. if you are on Ubuntu 18, you will see them in color.
That's unlikely.
Yeah, it's very unlikely. I've seen it happen. It actually works. So, I mean, you can have your smiling cats or whatever. This then is using this Docker machine to start a virtual box VM. Again, waiting for SSH access. It turns out most of the things where you're waiting for SSH access, it's actually generating the keys, waiting for entropy and things. It configures cryo as our container runtime. It prepares the Kubernetes environment. Then it loads the images from the cache. Then it runs a fairly central component for kubeproxy, which will proxy all the network connections to it. And you can do this yourself. You can start a VM, install a container runtime on it, install kube ADM on it, run the kube ADM. I mean, you can basically do all these things. But then you can have minikube do it for you as well. So we have one node actually called minikube. At the moment, it's not running anything, since we haven't started anything. But one thing that could be interesting to know is that most of Kubernetes is actually written as pods and as containers. So if we look in all namespaces, we will see that there are actually some kube system pods and containers running here. And these implement then the system. Apparently the dashboard is stuck. We'll see if it's around. Oh, nice. More. And then if the dashboard is up to it, we can log into the dashboard. The dashboard is now not started by default, so it will be deployed the first time you run it. This saves resources if you, for some reason, don't want the dashboard. The dashboard is quite nice, though. Most of the time we do. It's also a bit sad today. Anyway, we can, while it's doing whatever the dashboard is doing, we can, just so you can SSH into this soon after. So this is, the dashboard is then a web interface to Kubernetes. So here you can see the nodes. We have one node. You can see the work. Yeah, we haven't created any work, but we can see here all the system components and the resources they are occupying and so on. An interesting part about this container world is that when you see a CPU, it's now graded in millicores, and when you see memory, it's in megabytes. If you look at your VM, it's normally graded in whole CPUs and gigabytes. This is a fairly, it's a, maybe not so important, but still I find it a nice difference. And you can allocate half a CPU, that's a good way to do. You just get to share. And you can deploy things by creating a YAML somewhere or uploading it or picking from, yeah. So we won't go into too much on Kubernetes today, except that it's available. So we will go back behind the scene, see what happens here. And one thing I like about these systems is that since we have a dedicated VM for running this on, there's less other things running on this system, which makes it easier to see what is happening. So we have the init process. Minikube is using systemd, and we have these conmon processes. We have the initstar container, which is called pause, because that's normally what it does. It sleeps, waiting for the other containers to do the work. And here are then the main processes of the containers, and here are their threads doing stuff. So here's the API server, here's the database, HD. There's Influx and Grafana, and Heapster for doing those nice graphs. We have the DNS server for core DNS. So all of these have their conmon process, which I call runc to start this. And here is Cryo, which is then talking to Kubernetes. So it was implementing this runtime interface. So Kubernetes would give a command to Cryo, and Cryo would talk to the container runtime, which is runc. And then there is some systemd, system daemons, and here we are on the system. And this will, by default, it will occupy 2 vCPUs and 2 gigs of RAM on your laptop if you want to run the Minikube. You can adjust this if you want to run some larger applications. Yeah, so there you have it. Kubernetes running without the Docker daemon. So Cryo is used in production in OpenShift. Mm-hmm. So it's in the newest OpenShift version. Cryo is the default runtime. You can basically choose as a customer if you want to use the Docker runtime or the Cryo runtime.
Do they have like any feature difference at this point, or is it just?
It's mostly the Docker daemon that is the biggest difference between them, I would say. Also, the Docker doesn't fully implement the standard CRI, so So it's relying on a shim built into Kubernetes itself. So Kubernetes is basically bending over backwards to serve Docker as a default implementation, while everyone else gets to follow the standard and do the CI thing. So that's...
Do you think that will change?
Yeah, I mean, Docker has been working on a CLI implementation for a while. I think it will be done soon.
Yeah, that's one way of changing it. Another is to kind of drop all the Docker stuff.
Yeah, but then again, Docker is an open source project. So even though it does a lot of marketing, it's still an open source project in the core. It just seems a bit more focused on the Mac and Windows customer than Linux customers at the moment.
No, but I just mean it seems like it's also being implemented by other open source projects.
Yes.
Already, already existing stuff.
Yeah.
So you can switch the default to those two.
Yes.
There are some market forces causing that much like that.
Yeah.
Or user forces.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is one of the benefits of having a standard is that you can choose the best implementation. So there is nothing fundamentally wrong with Docker, except for the daemon, which has its pros and cons.
What are the pros and cons of running AWSD?
So
what are the benefits and drawbacks of running the way Docker does?
Yeah, okay. So it turns out that running everything as root without sudo is very convenient. So that's a pro and a con, because you're running everything as root, and then someone comes along in with a security, and oops, there it goes. So there's that. You have a daemon. So when I was implementing this, and it was pulling all these containers, and the code was basically pulling all of Kubernetes as containers, and then the Docker daemon would pull them one at a time. The cryo backend, or actually Podman in this case, were trying to actually do what I said and put everything at once. And then it ran out of RAM and crashed and died. So then I the mutex in order to you go first and then you answer. So having a centralized daemon means something you can talk to. So I think that Podman Kubernetes has made a good trade-off. So if you don't want a daemon, you can start Podman. And if you do want a daemon, then you can start Kubernetes, and then you get lots of daemons and things. And you get an API, and a REST API, something you can talk to. So you have, and they will both use the same containers and the same run speed under. Anyway, I think I will wrap this main presentation up by showing some links, I promise. I know I should press Shift F5, but I never do. Shift. So you can reach me on GitHub. And if you want to know more about these boot to Podman and Podman projects, there is a maybe not a blog would be the right word, but it has some posts. There are some concepts that I didn't have time to go into today. Like I made a Fedora ISO variant, mostly because the Reddit people was wondering why I didn't have one. There's one. It's 300 megabytes, but it's Fedora. So there are the containers I mentioned. You can run this thing. So normally you will download the ISO and run it, but you can also run the whole thing as a container. I'm using BinTray. I'm not sure if you know about BinTray. Maybe you heard about the artifact tool. Yeah, same guy. The Israeli company JFrog that came out, especially. There's the Go program, Go programming, there's a lot of Go involved in this. Yeah, there's some bits and pieces. Or just talk to me afterwards.
I have a question.
Yeah.
First question is, do you want more questions? Or do you want to wrap up? Because I have about five more.
Yeah, okay. So the thing is, I will be here. We have a lot of time left. We can do more questions. We said we were going to be about an hour, so if you need to run away, I will wrap up the main presentation and we can continue. And I'm thinking about having something on the community day related to containers in one way or another. Maybe this Linux kernel 4.20 thing needs to happen, someone needs to build that. There is this whole cryo project, which is very interesting, with a checkpoint and restore of containers, so you can teleport them to another machine. That's quite interesting. There is a lot of interesting things. And I can go on. But I will wrap up this main thing. I will leave this up here. And also in the meetup.
Yeah, I mean, generally we put up the video in a couple of days on foss-north.se and LinkedIn and so on, so we have it all.
Yeah, thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Now, if you need to leave or if you need to get some of the snacks, please feel free to do so. Yes.
Are there any more simpler ways to orchestrate Podman clusters? Kind of a Docker, you can use Ansible and Docker configuration managers.
So in terms of Ansible, I think there's an Ansible container project that will wrap it up into nice Ansible YAML things for you. Otherwise, you can write shell scripts. I'm mostly used to make files, it depends. I'm not sure what you want to do, but it's just a few runs, stop commands. If you have a complex Docker Compose file and you want to get like away from Docker, then there is a tool to convert it to Kubernetes for you. But there aren't too many tools for running pods using Podman because it's quite new. So there is some opportunity there if you have a nice idea or if you want to implement something. The main developers are kind of focused on ST-Linux and the core and so on, so there's a lot to do in terms of usability. But most of the features are there, so there's no real blockers. And it would be an interesting use case to show more application-like deployments. But again, if you have an application, maybe you should like it Kubernetes, if you want it to have it more replicated and survive a host crash.
Thank you. Do you share any code with Flatpak and Bobby?
No. You can also
ask questions. Why or why not?
I think both of them are, aren't they using the same OCI?
Yeah. I mean, most people are using 1C, except for Lennart. Lennart is using systemd and squat. It's like, I could do that. To be honest, I'm not really sure. What technologies are, so if, in case you didn't know, Flatpak and SnapD and some other projects are mostly ways to package desktop applications for desktop users. whereas Kubernetes and so on has been at least traditionally focused on packaging server applications. So there are some peculiarities about packaging desktop applications. It's mostly about creating desktop icons or showing GUIs and so on. So
when you started talking about the problem of executable,
yeah,
it sounded similar to me to bubble wrap, but then it changed. So bubble wrap, essentially, you can have any number of flags you can give it in order to say, you know, tweak what part of the namespaces should be sharing, what things
yes.
should be brought into the container.
Okay, so
and it's just a wrapper process that spawns the container.
Yeah. So one thing I didn't go into in the main talk was this concept of rootless containers.
Right.
And what that means is running containers without root. And it's doable today. The problem is that it needs a new kernel version, as in 4.14 or something. I mean, newer than my Ubuntu 16. Anyway. But it also needs a storage driver and a network driver, and that's where the problems come in. So there are some hopes of getting decent storage drivers and network drivers in Linux 4.20. But for now, you will have FUSE implementations of the storage and Slurper implementations of the network, so it's kind of limited. But it actually works. So even in the 1.0 release, you can do Podman run busybox without the sudo, mind you. And it will start the container for you, assuming
this
you...
This is what I thought that bubble wrap has done, I guess, or what it does today.
And this is using then something called Linux user namespaces, which I believe we have a talk on, Johan, is that correct?
Pardon?
We have a talk on Linux user namespaces, right, from a knowledgeable source on the foss-north.
Yes.
So that would be the place to ask, because I know next to nothing. All I know is you need this fancy new tool called new UID map. In some kind of head version of shadow users. And then you need to set up this magic mapping file that is called UID map. Something, UID something. Anyway, it maps the user IDs inside the container to user IDs outside the container. So you can be a root inside the container, but the view on the outside. I'm also happy to announce that it should work in Podman machine, boot Podman, whatever. So let's see if it does. Podman run something without root. It now uses a different Docker storage, now I have to put everything in. One downside of doing it in this environment at the moment is that it stores it on the ROM disk. So if you power the VM down, your images are gone. Yeah, it's a bit sad. No, sorry, we're in the business. Yeah. You can easily get confused here in this land of mirrors. I'll make it slightly bigger as well. This is then stored in share, I think. Local share containers. Storage. And it turns out to use this fancy FUSE thing, you need 4.18. So, yeah, it's a bit short there. So you get to use this VFS storage. It should be feature complete, but it will store multiple copies of the files. So it tends to be very big after a while, which is not what you want if you've been working with Docker images. You don't want them bigger, they're big enough already. And then there's this Slurp for net namespace networking stack that is kind of slow and horrible, but it also works. So it's available in the current release. Let's see if we can find this magic map. Yeah, sub-UID, that was the name of it. So this then should be the users inside my containers. They should start with the 100,000, and I should have 65,000 of them. So it allocates user IDs to use inside containers, so I can make sense of when I'm inside and out. And so that's the rootless containers. It actually works. Yes. Thank you for mentioning. What else do we have? We have this another thing. They invented this thing called varlink, which is some kind of protocol. Then I email on it. So there's a varlink command, and you can use that to call Podman, and then you can ask this to get a version, and it uses some kind of JSON API. So this is the remoting interface called varlink that you can write libraries to, and this if you recall this PyPodman program, it's using this varlink under the hood. So you can do list images and you will get a list of images. So this is how you remote call to it. It's also a feature being implemented. So it's Podman remote. Being implemented. Version works, images didn't want to talk. But it will be some kind of remoting API for once it's finished.
Coming back to the rootless images.
Yeah.
Can you build images rootless?
Sorry?
Can you build images without rootless as well?
Yes, you can build images without rootless. Most images. So some images actually require rootless.
So could you then also build the images?
So you can do build up from something. Alpine. And then you get the name of the container, and then you can do build up, run container, AP core, and iPhone or something big. So yes, you can do this, and then you can commit it as an image. You could if the network wasn't. So. but you can run a rootless. It's actually quite useful in Kubernetes, in that you can build inside Kubernetes. Pod, because those are not normally privileged. So Kubernetes doesn't have a way to build containers. It kind of, delegates that to the Docker daemon running locally or something. OpenShift has a way to build containers, but Kubernetes doesn't. Interesting.
So when you do a build, the default name becomes Alpine Working Container?
Yes.
Why not Alpine Working Container?
This is actually a container.
It is?
Yeah, you can. You could run commands on it. So when you commit it, then it becomes image.
Yeah. Okay. So it's just compared to Docker run.
So when you do build a run, it's comparable to run inside a Docker file. And when you do Podman run, it's similar to Docker run. So that's the difference between them.
Yeah. And that's kind of, it's not getting better. But it started with Docker being completely crazy.
Yeah. No, they cannot ruin it. Mm-hmm.
They could have gone with, I'm thinking back to Vagrant, for example.
Yes.
Vagrant was different in the way it was designed, and basically all you needed to do this stuff is a container runtime to Vagrant, but it has gone on a loop around some other, and now it seems, I mean, that seems kind of obsolete now compared to what you showed.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to run a special kernel, then you still have to run a daemon. So.
Right.
Actually, what they showed last year was fully full circle. So, what you can do nowadays is that you can use Kubernetes in order to allocate a virtual machine.
Right.
So, oh, yeah, they do this in OpenShift, right?
Yeah. So, then. Yeah, and they showed this like it was like a feature or something that you can actually now you can run MSSQL inside of Kubernetes as a virtual machine running Windows. And I was like, yeah, it's 2005 all over again, so VMware. Yeah, so but for, I mean, I can see it from an admin's point of view. Then you get one Kubernetes API that can talk to both containers and virtual machines. So if you have a service that is running in a VM today, and you're working on making a microservice migration out of it, so then you can grow into that solution. And there were like people were lining up with money and just handing it over to Red Hat. So I don't think it's
and there are other such projects as well.
Yeah. So for full disclosure, there are other.
Yeah.
It's called Kubevert, but it's basically running KVM inside a privileged Kubernetes pods. So it was from a management and salesman point of view, it was the best thing ever. But from a technical point of view, it was not so interesting.
I mean, it's also like a realistic case in how a lot of companies deploying them are looking, right? So,
yes.
I mean, they have some old shit that, you know, needs to run for a bunch of more years. So.
Yeah. So the most common question we're getting from Minikube at the moment is how do I run this virtual box inside my Ubuntu, inside my VMware? On my Windows 10 computer. So instead of asking container questions, it's mostly about nested virtualization. And then it comes a few Mac users and start to talk about native virtualization. And then you just... yeah. So if it's like running a hypervisor and it's running virtualization, then I normally don't call it native. Actually, no, I used to be a Mac user. He died. The spell broke. Now I'm free. any more questions? Or anyone asking, wanting me to show some, see something else? Sure. No, I see.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah.